Okay, yeah, I'm here working at Wageningen University and Research at the university part of Wageningen. At the moment, I'm head of the chair group Horticulture and Product Physiology. But maybe it's interesting to start where I came from. I grew up on a farm, and already when I was very small, I always was intrigued by how plants were growing. So I think I really have, from when I was that young, I have a passion for plants and to know how they are growing. So that's why I later studied horticulture, and now I've been for over 30 years in research on growing crops in greenhouses, in climate rooms, and in particular the last, let's say, 5 years or a little bit longer, that the vertical farming came into play.
You also studied in Wageningen?
Yes, I also studied here, and then thereafter I got a research position, and at that time I thought, well, in 5 years' time I will do work somewhere else. But for some reason I was so happy with what I was doing, and there were always new challenges that I stayed here, though it have been in many different departments, but always research on horticultural crops in greenhouses or vertical farms.
Could you tell us perhaps a bit about the current state of greenhouses?
Yeah, so the reason for the greenhouse is, we have a in winter it's relatively cool, so if you want to have a prolonged season, you need in fact warmer than, and that's why we have a greenhouse. The greenhouses here are almost always made of glass. And what then the growers noted, that they can not only extend the season, they get higher yields, they can now have year-round production, better quality. So I think these are the main reasons. In fact, what you see throughout the years, when it moved from open field to greenhouse, and now the greenhouse is getting more and more technology, is continuously a better control over the whole growth process, and the better control leads into to more product and a better product. And maybe if you realize that this continuously further increase in technology, then a vertical farm where plants are grown in a building, is then you can see it's maybe not so weird. It's in fact a logic next step of a further control over the production process.
Also, the greenhouses are mostly hydroponic ones in the Netherlands?
Yes, it depends. Most crops are grown soilless culture. I usually use myself the word hydroponics. I always find a bit confusing because some people have more limited definition or a wide definition. But in the wide definition, most of the crops are grown hydroponics. Not all. Chrysanthemum, for instance, is mostly grown in the soil. But if you're talking about cucumber, tomato, sweet pepper, roses, they're all grown soilless. So, and that can be on a substrate like a rock wool, that's the most common, but it can also be perlite, it can be cocoa fiber, all those different types of substrates, or just on a deep flow culture, so just water.
Was that because of some specialities of the soil in the Netherlands?
No, I think the main reason is the yield increase. And also, why is this the yield increase? Because now you can control the water and the nutrients around the roots more precisely. So it was the main reason was this yield increase, but it has also to do with pests and diseases. So the soil-borne diseases, I should say. In the old days, if there was a disease in the soil, then you would need to disinfect it. At that time, I think, 40 years ago, there was still 40, 50 years ago, was the methyl bromide. Well, then it was abandoned, so they could not use that disinfection because it is not good for our health. And then if you have this rock wool or other soilless culture, you can every year you can start over again in a clean system, and you don't need chemicals to disinfect.
Okay. So, what is the current state of vertical farming in the Netherlands? Let's say from a commercial point of view first.
Okay, so from a commercial point of view, I think we have to distinguish between two types of things. We have many companies constructing or building the vertical farms, or selling all the supplies for vertical farms, and that are mainly companies who are now active, who were already active in the greenhouse industry, and they have now seen, oh, this vertical farming, we can, with some adaptations, or we can also have supplies for that. So these companies have very big commercial activities, and they sell it worldwide. Probably your question relates more on, and what is then the production in the Netherlands? What are there vertical farms? There are not that many, I would say, yet starting up at this moment. There is one last year, a big farm, Future Crops, started in the Netherlands. Maybe it's even the biggest in Europe. But we see also many smaller initiatives, or we see also Own Greens, for instance. They came, that's a company who was already active in tissue culture. Now they also moved into the vertical farm on a large scale, but also in having systems where they grow it in a supermarket. And then the idea is that the consumers can see the plant growing, and yeah, there they can sell. So it's also quite a different business concept. So in general, yeah, there are now a few large ones, a number of small startup companies. What you also see, sometimes companies come up, and like GrowX, they are producing in the city of Amsterdam. Well, then they had some difficulties a year ago, and now they are restarting. So you can also, yeah, this is typically what happens in a new business. So it goes with ups and downs. Sometimes they have a delay or some problems. Some companies start over again, or some might disappear. But I'm sure a number of them will be very successful in the coming years.
Okay. And from a scientific point of view, I mean, I know there is a lot of research going on about vertical farming. Can you tell us a bit about what you see in Danny research?
Okay, yeah, so now you see the research is really expanding a lot, because we see, yeah, the compared to the greenhouse or the field, the plants are now growing at much higher rates. So you have different type of combinations of growing conditions. And to make fully use of that, our understanding is still rather limited. Or we find out that there are many more things that can be done to optimize. That's also what we saw last week at the VertiFarm, at the workshop. That also people said, well, you started with this, why did you choose this? And then people said, yeah, that was what I knew 2 years ago, and now we are more. So we are really, yeah, we have a steep learning curve. There is still so much to learn and to find out. And yeah, in fact, that's for us as researchers, as scientists. Yeah, that's wonderful. There's still so much to investigate. And all the results are also so relevant for the industry. And the problem is, so why is there so much to find out? Because there are so many interactions. Because it seems at first so simple. So, okay, there's an intensity and there is a color of the light. But then you find out that maybe depending on the intensity, you might maybe need another color. And then you think, oh yeah, a young crop might need something else as an older crop. But if you give more light, oh, the plant needs also more temperature, so you have to need a different balance between the temperature and the light, and then also change the CO2 concentration. And if you calculate that, you will see, oh, there are so many interactions. Yeah, and I think we are doing research on it, but all for the whole world, university groups are working on it. And I think that research community, yeah, we gradually move forward, and I think in that way we can help the industry.